And with that, I would like to start with Mark Cohen. Mark is a chief commercial officer at Unifly. And before joining this company, Mark held different positions in the IT and business process outsourcing industry, sales, pre-sales, and account management, including at Xerox. Mark is now leading the commercialization of the Unifly software suite on a global scale, and will certainly tell us more about this solution in a minute. Mark, stage is yours.
Thank you, George, for this introduction. So, I'm glad to be here. I'm the first UTM provider that will give the presentation. So I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what Unifly does. Let me see if I can figure this out. Yeah. So Unifly was founded in 2012 by two military air traffic controllers and a pilot. They saw drones were coming and knew that it was going to be a challenge integrating drones with in the existing airspace. One of the things that is key for the company is collaboration. So we work a lot together with drone manufacturers, drone detection systems, because we know we can't do it all. But the other thing that is critical for us is safety, making sure that we can integrate drones. We think the challenge isn't so much with commercial airliners because they fly at 11,000 feet or higher, where drones fly up to 500 feet. It's just a challenge around the airport. And helicopters, because they share the same airspace as drones do. They fly up to 500 feet. And a lot of those crafts, they don't have transponders on board, so you don't see them on a radar. So the big challenge for us is there, and we try to find solutions around that. So the Unifly platform has been created around the Unifly core, which is the back end we use. And we have modules targeted to drone operators and authorities. So on the left side, you see the end users, so the drone operators, the drone pilots, and additional service providers, companies like Amazon, like DHL, volocopters, air taxi companies. And on the right side, we have modules targeted specifically towards the authorities, towards the airspace managers, the air navigation service providers, police and local authorities. And in the presentation, I talk a little bit more of the modules we have for those authorities. Now, on the top side, you see the demand aviation, because it is important to integrate those. There are some discussions going on, because the air traffic controllers, they've got enough on their plate already. They don't want to see the drones on their screens. And at the bottom, which is important, is what we call the UTM client. The UTM client is our link to our partners and other companies. So we've got an open API, so you're able to link to a drone and get the information, the telemetry from the drone in the platform. Not all of the drones can do that, so we have different devices that can be put on the drone to make them visible. Some of the technologies are ADS-B, which is used in manned aviation as well, but it's low-powered ADS-B, so it's a different frequency. We got trackers that transmit the location of the drone over the cellular network. We got trackers that use satellite navigation, and then some others that use FLARM, which is a protocol that is used a lot in Europe for gliders. So we support all of those trackers, and with that we can make drones visible to the authorities. And then the ground control stations, which is important as well. We link to a number of ones, so you make your mission in the ground control station, you put your flight plan in. That is then sent to our platform where you do the validation, and then later on you can track via the ground station where the drone is flying. There's one bullet missing, something we've been working on for the last couple of months, is integration with drone detection systems like drone radars where they see drones, which is important as well, and we link to them as well. We've done a European project and had presented the first results 2 weeks ago. So the drone radar detects all of the drones that are in the area. They give that feed to our platform. We know which drones should be flying there, so we can distinguish the cooperative drones with the non-cooperative drones. And we've shown that in the UK 3 weeks ago. So looking at the UTM functionalities, these are the functionalities we've got in our integrated in our platform. So we got drone registration and identification. It can be handled within the Unifly platform completely, or if the country has a drone registration system already, we can link into that registration system. A good example there is what we're doing in Belgium right now. The CA in Belgium, they have a system where all of the drone operators that have a commercial license are already registered, and we link into that platform. So they register in our platform, we link up to the system from the CA in Belgium, and we get all of the information of the drone pilots for that operator and the drones that are registered under which he can fly with his license. And that information is getting imported into the Unifly platform, and then he can do his flight planning using those drones. The information we get from the Belgian CAA, you can't change that information in our platform. They can add additional drones. They want to fly with outside of their license, but the drones within their license, it's impossible to change them. Then the second part is dynamic airspace management. So we have airspace information, validated airspace information into our platform, which we're getting from validated sources. Next to that, it is possible for the authorities to add additional no-fly zones. So in Denmark, for example, they added police stations, embassies, prisons, federal buildings, and nature reserves, because those are no-fly zones in Denmark. In Germany, they did the same. I'm not going to name them all because it's a nightmare there. If you're a commercial drone operator and want to fly, there's not a lot of space. Because, for example, if there's a waterway which has commercial traffic on it, you can't fly over it with a drone. So all of that information can be put into the system using our dynamic airspace management module. Also, it gives you the possibility to create no-fly zones on the fly. So, for example, an accident happened on the highway, you don't want people flying over it, you just point and click over that area, create a no-fly zone, say from when till when it is valid, and the information will be pushed out to the system immediately. So drones that are flying will get an alert via our mobile app. If you have an operation that is impacted by it but not active, the operators will get an email informing them the airspace has changed, their flight isn't valid anymore, and they need to relook at their flight plan. The next one is drone surveillance and tracking, so that's keeping an eye where the drones are, but also giving alerts when a drone comes close to manned aviation, or a drone comes close to a drone, or a drone is flying into a no-fly zone. We're also working on, if you have your flight plan, that we know that area, so if your drone is going outside of the plan that you've made, you'll get an alert as an airspace manager as well. Which is also part of the dynamic drone fly management, and then we've got drone flow management as well. So I've touched on it a little bit, but we got some functionalities targeted to the authorities. So one of the things is to reach out to your community and have that information easy, accessible, and easy readable. A lot of the drone operators and the drone users, also the recreational ones, they haven't got a clue what the aviation rules are. If you talk to them about a CTR or an HTA, they don't know what it is. So we make sure that we inform that audience with easy information that is accessible and readable for them. For that, we have a web page which gives a no-fly zones map, which just is a static web page, as well as a mobile app with which the user can, on their location, check whether they can fly or not. Then manage the airspace, manage the access to the airspace. I already mentioned publishing no-fly zones in real time. We got automated instantaneous flight approvals based on local rules and regulations. But also a manual authorization process flow. So if your flight can't be validated manually, but you need to go to a process, need to fill in a form, get some additional information and some documentation sent out to the authorities, we can support that. So we've got that automated flow in our platform. We collect all of the information that is needed and then send that to the authorities that need to do the authorizations. And that can be multi-level. So it can be going out to the CAA that needs to give an authority. It can be that a local municipality needs to give an authority as well. In Europe, we're working with some harbors that want to have something to say about the airspace as well. So we can have different level of authorities being given in that, that manual process. We can send notifications out to the pilots, notifications that they're flying into a no-fly zone, notification that the airspace has been changed, a notification they're coming close to another drone operator or a manned aircraft. And we manage the database, so the registered pilot and the registered drones are into our system. We got flight logbooks, so we keep log of all of the flights that have been used, special authorizations you need to bid on. All of that information is kept into our platform. Is there been an incident? You can log that as well and send the incident report to the necessary authorities you need to do. Monitor flight traffic in real time, so real time flight visualization and statuses, and also alerts if something comes close to you that shouldn't be there. And as I said, we've got multiple levels of authorities. And then the functionalities for the RPAS or the UAV operators. So easy to use mobile and web applications. There's limited aviation knowledge that has been needed to be able to use those platforms. We got complete and accurate national and local rules into our platform. Do we have them in our system for the globe? No, we do it step by step. We have to look at the local rules and regulations, but it takes us 2 to 3 weeks to implement it. I can give a demo in the exposition area later on. We've got some of the rules and regulations from Tanzania in our platform, and the airspace information like national parks and all of those. It took us 3 weeks to implement it. So it's not a long effort. The challenge quite often is getting the right rules and regulations from the different countries. Plan and validate your operations, so you can plan your operation in our platform, have it validated, have an automatic flight approval if that's possible, or do the manual authorization flow. And you can also manage your pilot crew and your drone fleet. So you can be a dispatcher using our platform, planning the operation and assigning the operation to one of your pilots, and he then will be notified that he has an operation and then he can execute the operation. And also as a drone operator, you can keep track of your flights. You'll also see other drones flying in the area and manned aviation. The difference with the authorities, on the authorities, if you click on the craft, you get the information of the pilot, the information of the operator and the drone. For the operator, if you click on it, you only get that information for your own drones. So if another drone is flying, you see that the drone is flying there, but you don't get the personal information of the person or the company that is behind. Implementing a UTM system, in our experience, is a step-by-step approach. You don't implement UTM, full UTM, as of one day. So the way we've been implementing it is, so reach out effectively to your community first. Make sure you've got readable information, easy to access channels, have a no-fly zones map, and instantaneous flight approvals via a mobile app. The second step is manage the airspace, publish no-fly zones, have the flight authorization process in place, notify the pilots, and manage the database of the registered drones and the registered pilots and the licensing provides. And then the third step is monitor the drone traffic in real time, have real time flight status and tracking, visualize both the manned and the unmanned, and do conflict resolution. There is a fourth step, which we don't have on a slide here, which is in the far future, where you have really autonomous drones that have artificial intelligence in there, and there's no pilot involved anymore. The drones take off, and then the software in the drone will do the deconfliction. So we'll be sending all of the information from the UTM system to that drone, and it will be the artificial intelligence in the drone that will handle and change flights based on the information he's receiving. This is an example of an UTM solution with some roles and responsibilities. So we have our web application for the pilots, the mobile application for the drone operators once they are flying. We can link to the ground station as well, so it can either be our mobile app or the mobile app from the ground station. We are linked to the NOTAM database, so every minute we're checking the NOTAM database, we're getting NOTAMs into our system and parse them. Which is a challenge because sometimes there are some typing errors in the NOTAM and it's difficult to parse the NOTAMs. And then if you've got modules for the regulator, the CAA, so registration and special authorities, and then some modules for the admin supervisors, which can be the CAA as well, the ANSP, the Department of Transport, airports, emergency services, local authorities. They will have the map manager where they can create dynamically and temporary no-fly zones, and they have flight view where they can see where the planes and the drones are flying. Now, what makes the UniFly solution unique? Safety is in our DNA. In our management team, we have two pilots, and they're not drone operators. If I say a drone pilot in the office, I get slapped because they say drone pilots aren't real pilots. We are. We got two air traffic controllers into our management team and two drone operators. And then some other people who have an IT background. So safety really is in our DNA. We got state-of-the-art technology. We got a clear long-term vision where we want to go. Unmanned for us is more than drones. We are looking to urban air mobility, but also urban mobility, so unmanned vehicles on the ground as well. A good example there is Airbus with their air taxi they're building. It's a drone, but it will land, then the propellers will go off, and it will continue driving. So as a UTM system, do you just want to monitor the air taxi when it's in the air and then lose track when it's driving? We think the UTM system will manage all of that. And we got some good experience. We got four ANSPs in Europe that are using our platform. So Deutsche Flugsicherung in Germany, Navier in Denmark, Austrocontrol in Austria, and then Belgocontrol in Belgium. But we're also globally active. So we are the UTM service provider in New York State in the US. And we also have a collaboration with Hitachi. What they did is they translated our screens into Japanese, and they are now pushing the UTM system in Japan using the UniFly backend. Okay, that's been my presentation.